example, in Manuba and all over the country. So we were teaching people how to make movies, but telling them that this country will not accept anything they create. They just have to go somewhere else. But we want to have, we want to maintain the Tunisian cinematic identity, but we don't want it to be attacky. We don't want it to reflect on us, because just like Raghib Ben Ali wanted to be president for life. So he, but he didn't want to seem oppressive. So he created this contradicting, conflicted context, closing down cinemas and at the same time creating and allowing new schools for cinema. And this led to a less structured and less homogenous situation in which the creators were there, but the market wasn't. And that is why most of the movies were cautiously controversial. The movies that were allowed into the country, they were cautiously controversial. They were, they kind of continued with the radical waves of the 90s that we talked about, with addressing social issues rather than political issues, sexuality, gender, education, not attacking the government, not attacking the presidency, but they were not completely non-ideological, they were subtly political. Here we see the return to the woman as a symbol of the nation, as a symbol of a lost cause, as a symbol of an aborted dream that could never happen. And one more thing before we go. We also noticed that there's this thing that people have, this prejudice about Tunisian cinema, which they keep calling it vulgar or too erotic because of the nudity scenes. But many critics argue that it's actually a representation of the bond between eroticism and sentimental romanticism, because one of the visual ways to represent vulnerability, to represent the ability to expose yourself, the ability to let yourself be heard, is through nudity, because when we are naked, not just physically but emotionally, that's when we are most vulnerable, but also when we are most true to ourselves. And that is why the cinema of the 2000s is kind of a third space cinema. Third space as in it's the product of many varying elements. The rise of cinema schools, the decrease of the market, the move to other countries to be able to create, and this led to movies that are political but personal, political but social, personal but universal. We have movies that, for example, start with portraying this fairy tale tone of a girl going from the capital to, from the country to the capital, in this Cinderella story to meet this guy that he loves her, and then in the middle of the movie the tone switches. It becomes completely dark, it becomes horror. We see blood, we see her chased through the city, we see her bitten by dogs, and it becomes completely dark, and you're just hit with a sudden shift. It's not even subtle. And that mix of genres makes it a third space cinema. It is a mix of so many things coming together in this context where we are influenced and bombarded by so many contradicting ideas that you cannot have a unanimous, a subtle, a unified identity. And the movie I chose to talk about in this era, is Silence by Karim Souak, 2008, and it's a mixture of documentary and fiction. It talks about an HIV-positive man who becomes an activist in association, struggling against AIDS. The movie is both dignifying and belittling. It's both social and political, because it does not only address the social status of HIV-positive man or woman, but it also addresses how the government ignores this issue, because during that period, AIDS was a major topic in social circles across the country. Across the country, we were afraid about AIDS because it just happened, and a decade ago, America had an epidemic of AIDS. So we were worried, we were extra worried, but the government was doing nothing. Not spreading awareness, not explaining, not promoting safe sex, nothing. And this contrast between the social concern and the political indifference created this notion of having to fight but not knowing to fight, because you're not raising awareness of the people because they already know, and you cannot change the government because they already excluded you from the context completely and told you go produce somewhere else. So you're fighting an enemy that you cannot even go into battle with. You're just fighting from afar.
Because they, I remember that when the problem, when they started talking about this issue, the health issue, they said, mm-hmm.